I'm proposing stabilize and other integrity traits. We have existing set of we have existing set of integrity levels in JavaScript as background, frozen, sealed, and non-extensible, where the arrow on this diagram represents implies. If an object is frozen, then it's sealed. If an object is sealed, then it's non-extensible. So going up the chart, we have stronger integrity levels. And these integrity levels were introduced in order to support high integrity programming. And they've served that function rather well, but there are still some weaknesses that we'd like to address. In this diagram, by the way, on the left, we have the functions that bring about the integrity levels. And on the right, we have the predicates that test an integrity level. And the middle is the name of the integrity levels as states an object can be in. And the bulk of the presentation will focus on the states. So when considering introducing new features like the integrity levels, your integrity traits I'm about to show, this raises the question about when should a new feature be considered an integrity trait? So there are several aspects of the existing integrity levels that we're going to take to be defining of what it means for something to be an integrity level, which is that it's a monotonic one-way switch. For example, once an object is frozen, it is always frozen. That it brings about stronger object invariance so as to better support higher integrity programming to make things more predictable. And that if a proxy has an integrity level, if and only if its target has the same integrity level. So for example, a proxy is frozen if and only if its target is frozen. And this if and only if upholds the idea that the target is the entirety of the bookkeeping. To keep track of whether the proxy should be considered to have that integrity level. There's also a distinction between the existing integrity levels that we'll be carrying forward, which is some integrity levels are explicit and some are emergent. What I mean by that is that non-extensible is an explicit integrity level because it's a fundamental part of the semantic state of the object that has to be represented explicitly both in the spec and in any implementation, whether an object is non-extensible or not. And an object only comes to be non-extensible if it's explicitly made non-extensible, whereas sealed and frozen are emergent integrity levels. In that they are defined by a conjunction of other conditions, and if that conjunction holds, then the object is considered sealed or frozen independent of how that conjunction came to be. So, for example, if I have an object that is non-extensible but has a single own configurable property, it is not sealed or frozen, but if I delete that property, then the object becomes both sealed and frozen because a sealed object is just a non-extensible object in which all properties are non-configurable, all own properties are non-configurable, and frozen is a sealed object in which all own data properties are also non-writable. And a particular reason why this distinction is important is that there's only proxy traps for the explicit integrity levels. There's a prevent extensions trap as an and an is extensible trap, because that's the fundamental state change that the proxy needs to be able to intervene in. There is no proxy traps for that correspond to sealed or frozen. So the way we got started on this journey is that we are doing hardened JavaScript, and we're doing the Sesshim as a library for implementing hardened JavaScript. The Modable XS engine also implements hardened JavaScript directly, and hardened JavaScript is explicitly trying to support much higher integrity programming for JavaScript, and it has a operation implemented as a library, implemented as a library in the Sesshim, implementable as a library, which is harden, which is a transitive deep freeze, transitive by own property walk and inheritance walk, walking up the inheritance chain, walking forward along all properties, and applying the freeze operation to all objects it encounters. We are not in this presentation proposing harden as an integrity level or anything else. It's just an example of a library that that has proven to be useful. And the important point of it is that it tamper-proofs an API surface by freezing each object at each step of the transitive walk. Harden.js, in addition, hardens all the primordials. So all the primordial objects, all of the built-in intrinsic objects that exist before any code starts running, which are all hardened before a code starts running. And the result is that these are the objects that are implicitly shared by all code running in the same realm. And by hardening them all before code starts running in that realm, you're in a position to isolate the effects of that of different portions of code from each other. And we've been doing that. We've been doing that since ECMAScript 5 days under other names. But we've found that there are three weaknesses that we would like to address. So our first try was to address all three weaknesses with one additional stronger integrity level, which we're calling stable. And the idea would be that the harden operation I referred to would be changed so that instead of freezing the object at each step of the transitive walk, it instead stabilizes each object at every step of the transitive walk. And by addressing all three of these weaknesses, the stable integrity level would be strong enough. However, in talking with Shu in a hallway conversation at the last plenary, we realized that a major motivating use for one of the changes that stable would introduce, one of the stronger invariants, would be extremely useful for the structs and shared structs proposal. And I'll be getting to the specifics of that as to why it would benefit shared structs. But the key thing is that if that new feature is brought in only by the stable integrity level, and stable implies frozen, then it cannot be applied to structs. Structs cannot benefit from this introduction because structs themselves cannot be frozen. Non-shared structs can actually be frozen, but they need to benefit from this feature even in their initial non-frozen state. They generally are objects that you, for most purposes, won't want to freeze because they have properties that are mutable, but the key thing is that structs are supposed to have to admit an efficient fixed shape implementation. And in current JavaScript, there's no way to do that compatibly with the language. And this new feature that would have been introduced by Stable would have enabled structs to have fixed shape, but only if this new feature could be applied to non-frozen objects. So Jim's Barksdale of Netscape has famously said, there's only two ways to, in his case, make money in business. One is to bundle, the other is to unbundle. So let's examine a full unbundling of the features of all of our integrity levels into separate explicit orthogonal as possible integrity levels. And now, because these are in a graph, not a fully ordered hierarchy, we're going to shift away from the term levels for all of these and just refer in general to integrity traits from now on rather than integrity levels. So with these fully unbundled into separate explicit traits, this gives us a good framework for talking about what each of the separate features would be that address the different weaknesses. So fixed is the one that would enable struct to be a fixed shape. Right now in JavaScript, there's this feature return override such that if, for example, a superclass constructor ends by explicitly returning some value, then in the super following the super call in the subclass constructor. Can everybody see my mouse moving, by the way?
Yes.
Okay, great. In the super call in the subclass constructor, following that super call, the this in the subclass is bound to the value that was returned by the superclass constructor. It is not bound to the object that was behind the scenes made, you freshly made to be an instance of the class. And also at this point when the subclass constructor takes control, the private fields, pound value in this case, are added to whatever object got returned. And that's the case even if that object is frozen. It's possible to actually use this to build a weak map-like abstraction that this code example is extracted from. The proposal repo has a more complete code for an emulated weak map that just uses return override. And the key thing here is that if the subclass constructor is called with a struct object as the key and some value, then the language would obligate the implementation to add this private field to the struct. Now, the specification accounts for this semantics of how is it that these things can be added to frozen objects. It accounts for this by saying that private fields have a weak map-like semantics. But practically, all high-speed implementations we're aware of, in particular all browser implementations that we're aware of, all actually add the private fields by a hidden shape change of the object. So in the V8, where different shapes of objects have different hidden classes, they call it, for the internal bookkeeping, for keeping track of the shape, this would have to change the hidden class behind the struct. And this conflicts with a lot of the high performance goals that that are motivating of the Strux proposal. So the idea is that if an object is fixed, then it cannot be extended with using this return override trick. It cannot be extended to have new private fields. And in fact, there is a precedent for this already in the language, which is by special dispensation, the browser global window proxy object is already exempt from having private fields added to it. And this is again motivated by different implementation constraints. But again, it's motivated by enabling the implementation to avoid having to do something complex in order to implement a feature that nobody actually cares about for that case anyway. So retcon on the slide here is retroactive consistency or retroactive continuity. It's a fan fiction practice of trying to retroactively rationalize something that had been a special case. So if we introduce fixed, then we also get to retcon this special dispensation of window proxy and say that instead that the window proxy simply carries the fixed integrity trait. And this solves another problem with the special dispensation, which is the special dispensation on the window proxy means that it's impossible for a library to do a fully faithful emulation of a browser window proxy on a non-browser platform because of the inability for that emulation to prohibit the addition of the private field. The introduction of the fixed trait would make that same exemption available to an emulated window proxy. Okay, the next one is the overridable integrity trait, which would be an exemption from the assignment override mistake. So the assignment override mistake is, I think the example code here explains it very well. Ignoring the first object freeze line, the second two statements here, there's a tremendous amount of legacy code on the web, in particular before the introduction of classes, that used this pattern in order to create class-like abstractions. So a function point that's acting like a construction function, and then using this assignment to add a toString method to the point.prototype object that overrides the toString that's inherited from object toString. Now, what many projects have found is that in attempting to freeze the primordials in order to create a more defensible environment, in order, for example, to inhibit prototype poisoning, that they immediately break legacy code like this in that environment because the assignment override mistake is that you cannot override by assignment a non-writable property that's inherited. So in particular, the object freeze makes the toString property on object prototype a non-writable data property, which therefore cannot be overridden on point.prototype with assignment. So that in a strict environment throws, in a sloppy environment even worse, it just fails silently and the program proceeds to then misbehave in weird ways. The idea here would be that If the object is made overridable, then if the object prototype object in this case is made overridable, then its non-writable properties can be overridden by assignment in objects that inherit from the overridable object. So the parenthetical here is to say that there are still some people on the committee that believe that we might be able to fix the assignment override mistake globally for the language as a whole. I have no opinion one way or the other on this. I'm very, I'd like to offline find out more about the evidence pro and con that, but we're just taking the position that if it could be fixed globally for the language as a whole, rather than introduce an integrity trait, we would prefer that. And if that were to happen, we would remove the overridable trait from this proposal and just accept it as a global language fix. But if not, then this is how we propose to fix it for objects that opt in to the fix by adopting this integrity trait. When writing defensive programs, in particular programs that are are defensive against possible misbehavior of their arguments, possible surprising arguments, it's very nice to be able to do some upfront validation early in the function to check that, to validate that the arguments are well behaved in the ways that the body of the function will then proceed to count on, to rely on. And a particular pervasive need for this is that many functions that are responsible for maintaining an invariant have to also momentarily suspend the invariant, do something, and then restore the invariant. And while the invariant is suspended, they are in a delicate state. For example, a function that splices a doubly linked list must go through a moment in time where the doubly linked list is ill-formed before the doubly linked list comes to be well-formed again. And while it's in this delicate state with suspended invariants, it is quite often vulnerable to reentrancy hazards. So if code that was brought in by the argument could interleave surprisingly during an operation that you do while the invariant is suspended, then that interleaved code might re-enter foo. So record-like here is named inspired by the records and tuple proposal. If, for example, we validated that the suspect argument was JavaScript primitive data, then within the delicate region, we can operate on primitive data without any worry, because primitive data we know does not observably transfer control to any other code brought in by the primitive data. Our records and tuples would create object-like records, which are still primitive data and still have this guarantee of no interleaving, and therefore no worry about interleaving hazards. What we're proposing is that the one The one source of interleaving hazards that we cannot validate do not exist in the language as it is today is interleaving via proxy handler traps. Even if record-like to ensure that the object cannot interleave, checks that the object is frozen, that it inherits only from something record-like, and that it has no accessor properties, all of that together is still does not give you safety if the object happens to be a proxy. So the idea is that if the if record-like additionally checks that the object is non-trapping, then what that would mean is that if a non-trapping object is used as the target of a proxy, that no operation on the proxy traps to the handler, rather all operations on the proxy go directly to the target. To put it another way, the proxy acts exactly like the target in all ways, except that the proxy and target continue to have separate object identity. This simple way of specifying non-trapping, which is what we favor, is sensible if non-trapping implies frozen, so that the only objects you can make non-trapping are frozen objects, because the object invariants already enforce that if the target is frozen, that the only things the handlers can do is they can interleave other code during the access, or they can throw. They cannot change the result of any of the proxy traps. So because the handlers are already mostly useless for frozen objects, but it's certainly too late to make proxies on frozen targets non-trapping, the idea would be that this additional opt-in would make proxies on non-trapping frozen objects non-trapping and therefore not able to cause interleaving. And it does this while still not providing an ability in the language to test whether an object is a proxy or not. So it does not break practical membrane transparency while still turning off this interleaving feature of the non-trapping proxies thereby mitigating the proxy reentrancy hazard. As long as we are considering a full unbundling of integrity traits, we could additionally consider unbundling non-extensible into its two orthogonal components. And this would serve another retcon our purpose. It is already the case by special dispensation that the window proxy object, you cannot change what object it inherits from, and the object prototype object is born inheriting from null, and again, by special dispensation, you cannot change what object it inherits from. You cannot change it to inherit from something else, even when both of these objects are extensible, which is, you know, they're certainly both born extensible. But nevertheless, they have this restriction. By making this an explicit integrity trait, we can retcon window proxy and object prototype to account for this special behavior. And again, We also enable higher fidelity emulations of the browser global window proxy object on non-browser platforms by making this this selective prohibition on changing prototype available on objects that are otherwise extensible. And then finally, if we unbundle non-extensible into its two features, this one is the other feature, which by separating that into a separate integrity trait would allow one to make an object that in which new own properties could not be added, but the object itself, you could still change what it what object it inherits from. So this would be the maximally unbundled picture. The solid arrows are the implies. The question mark dotted arrows are the maybe implies to be explored and discussed. It's an open design issue. The only really compelling case for the dotted arrow is non-trapping implies frozen. It is actually possible to specify non-trapping if we relax that it implies frozen, but it is quite a complicated specification that probably does not, where the extra complexity probably does not serve any actual purpose. So there's a problem with this full unbundling, which is this has five orthogonal explicit integrity traits. And in general, we like orthogonality as a language design principle. It's more expressive. It's more future-proof with regard to a picture that can accommodate future additions more smoothly, but is it really worth 10 new proxy traps to support these five traits? And in our opinion, the current opinion of the champions of the proposal, it is not. So one way to solve this would be, instead of creating 10 new traps, just create two new parameterized proxy traps that take a integrity trait name, protect, which brings about the integrity trait, and is protected, which tests for the presence of the integrity trait. This would this raises a design question that's not necessarily fatal. It's just an open design question for which, you know, we've imagined answers, none of which we like, but all of which are coherent, as to how the new traps protect and is protected would coexist with prevent extensions and is extensible, since now those would be existing traps that existing handlers use, but they now would correspond to what is effectively a new emergent, a retroactively emergent integrity level. So when would an operation on the proxy trap to prevent extensions versus when would it trap to protect non-extensible? The other approach to the cost of having so many different integrity traits and so many different explicit integrity traits is to rebundle to the minimal picture that still addresses the issues that we find strongly motivating. So this would simply not unbundle non-extensible, leave it as an explicit integrity trait, forego the retcon of permanent inheritance property of object prototype and window proxy, and also fold both overridable and non-trapping back up into stable. So basically, this picture is very much like the picture of our first try, with the only difference being that fixed is broken out as a separate trait. And in this minimal picture, we choose not to have any implication error from fixed to any other trait, so that fixed can be applied by itself. And this would still enable retconning that aspect of the window proxy, since the window proxy is extensible, and therefore, if fixed implied even non-extensible, you could not apply it to the window proxy. So altogether, just speaking for myself as one of the champions, I will say that I find this minimal picture to be the most attractive, even though it's foregoing some of the benefits of the further unbundlings. But of course, any intermediate picture between the fully bundled and the fully unbundled picture are plausible points for this exploration to settle. And this is being proposed for stage one, so exploring the design space is certainly the appropriate exploration in stage one, not settling on a particular preference necessarily going in. And at this point, I will break for questions, but first I will, as agreed, stop the recording.